Have you ever put time into a plant just to have it die early due to disease? When I first started gardening, I discovered in my first season that I had a root knot nematode problem because my eggplant barely produced and the roots were all gnarly. When I decided to put tomatoes in the ground the next year, I was very selective on the cultivar I used because of my nematode problem. Root knot nematodes affect all solanaceous crops, which tomatoes and eggplants both are. I planted seeds to grow my transplants and selected seeds that had an N, which stood for root knot nematode resistance, in the description online. The Big Boy hybrid tomato cultivar was one of those. That year I grew plenty of tomatoes, although not 342 pounds of fruit from one plant as the description says. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and in this video I'm going to talk about host resistance or tolerance as an integrated pest management strategy. Pest-resistant plants, when available, are one of the most effective and least expensive pest management tools. Resistant plant cultivars have inherited characters that result in less pest damage or infestation than other varieties of that species under comparable conditions in the field. Although the terms variety and cultivar are frequently used interchangeably, plants produced through breeding programs are most accurately called cultivars. Variety can also refer to naturally occurring variants in a subspecies. Plant cultivars bred to resist pests are a major tool in management of plant pathogens and nematodes and have been used effectively against a number of insects and plant pathogens. In the example on the slide, a cultivar of nematode-resistant cotton is being tested in Florida with obvious results. Although extremely valuable, the use of pest-resistant cultivars is not foolproof. Occasionally, a resistant plant can become more susceptible to pest pressure as a reaction to physical stress, such as variations in moisture, evaporation, plant and soil nutrition, and temperature. For example, Lahontan cultivars of alfalfa are much more susceptible to stem nematode at 77 degrees Fahrenheit than at 59 degrees Fahrenheit. An even more serious concern is the potential for development of biotypes or physiological races of pests that can overcome the factors that provide the basis for host resistance. Integrating the use of resistant cultivars with other management tools such as sanitation, crop rotation, or certified seed can help prolong the useful life of a resistant cultivar. Many scientists distinguish between tolerance and true resistance. Tolerant plants are able to endure the presence of a pest with little or no long-term damage. However, tolerant varieties sometimes support populations of a pest that can infest subsequent susceptible crops. Plants with true resistance support few or no pest individuals and have physiological or morphological characters that affect the behavior, anti-zoonosis, or biology, antibiosis, of the pest. Anti-zoonosis, or non-preference, includes changes in plant color, odor, hairs, or leaf texture that make the plant unattractive or repellent. For example, certain cultivars of chrysanthemum give off odors that repel the melon aphid, and alfalfa resistant to potato leafhopper is hairier, making it difficult for them to feed. An example of antibiosis would be chemicals produced by the resistant cultivar that inhibit spore germination or mycelium growth or development of an insect. Host resistance is most effective and long-lasting if it relies on more than one gene, preferably on more than one character, for its mechanism of resistance. Such polygenic or horizontal resistance slows the development of individual infections, slowing epidemics and making it more difficult for the pest to develop strains, biotypes, able to overcome the resistance factors. Plant pathologists refer to resistance that results from the activity of one or a few closely linked genes as vertical resistance. Vertical resistance impacts major functions of specific pathogens. As a result, vertical resistance is often very effective and very specific to a pathogen race or group, but sometimes rapidly selected against by the pathogen. In some cases, vertical resistance may inhibit the initial establishment of pathogens, thereby inhibiting the development of epidemics. On the other hand, resistance that is horizontal, polygenic, involves numerous minor processes and defenses working together that affect most strains of a pathogen. In the figure, variety B shows a greater level of horizontal resistance, which reduces damage from a wide range of pathogen races. The two cultivars differ in their level of vertical resistance, which determines the extent to which they are damaged by specific races of the pathogen. When choosing a cultivar, the grower must consider the races of the pathogen most prevalent in the area. One of the most critical decisions in orchard and vineyard crops affecting management practices, pest damage, and profits throughout the life of a tree or vine is the selection of rootstock and scion cultivars. The scion is a shoot or bud that is grafted onto a rootstock to develop into the trunk and branches of a tree or vine. Scion choice determines the harvested crop variety, pest resistance above the graft, and many other production and market considerations. Rootstocks are primarily chosen by growers to control tree vigor and improve fruit or nut size and quality, cold hardiness, and adaptability to climate and soil conditions. Resistance or tolerance of rootstocks to insects, diseases, nematodes, and other pests is another major factor in rootstock selection. In Florida, much effort has been put into Hualongbing or HLB tolerant citrus rootstock. As shown in the figure with Cleopatra rootstock that is susceptible to HLB and US 897, which is tolerant as compared to the HLB free seedlings. Developing pest resistance in cultivated plants is just one of many objectives of plant breeding and genetic improvement programs. Plant breeders must balance the need for resistance to important pests and diseases with other objectives, such as improved yield and quality. You can have a disease-resistant tomato, but if you breed the taste out of it, then no one will want it. To develop a resistant cultivar, researchers must first locate plants with suitable resistant characters. These are typically found in wild variants of the same species or closely related species. With new bioengineering techniques, resistance characters may now be derived from different plant genera or even unrelated organisms. Historically, the development of resistant cultivars has depended largely on finding sources of resistance in host populations and propagating them through sexual reproduction. Various techniques have been used to select genetic material useful in suppressing disease. Occasionally, a disease epidemic in an area will isolate resistant individuals in the field and provide an almost ready-made resistant variety. However, far more often, a laborious breeding program is required to develop a new resistant cultivar. Such programs require identification of resistant material by infesting plants and selecting the least susceptible individuals, incorporating the resistance into varieties with desirable agronomic attributes through sexual reproduction, and screening offspring for effectiveness of resistance and other desirable qualities as seen in the development of IR36, a cultivar of corn that is semi-dwarf, early maturing, and high quality with multiple disease and insect resistances. Development of a single cultivar may take many years, although new tissue culture and bioengineering techniques can shorten this time substantially. Hybrids are the offspring of a cross of two different purebred lines. The heterozygous offspring often combine the superior characters of the two lines and also increase the vigor of the crop. Cell and tissue culture, as well as techniques such as genetic engineering and irradiation, allow plant breeders to more rapidly develop new varieties of plants without having to carry out the time-consuming tasks of crossing plants through sexual reproduction and selecting for desirable qualities over many generations. Cell and tissue culture techniques allow all breeders to propagate entire plants from a single cell or group of cells. This approach vastly decreases the time required to propagate and identify new material. Genetic engineering techniques allow all breeders to transfer genetic material, DNA, from one organism to another. DNA transfer opens up vast new resources of pest-resistant genetic material. For woody perennials, budwood may be irradiated to induce mutations that may confer desirable traits. These newly developed tissues will generally be grafted onto rootstocks and grown to maturity to assess their usefulness. However, these modern biotechnological techniques still decrease by years the amount of time required to propagate and identify new plant material. Transgenic pest-resistant cultivars result from the transfer of desirable traits from one organism to another. In classical breeding programs, only closely related species can be crossbred. Using transgenic techniques, plant breeders can transfer the genetic material from completely unrelated organisms. Genetic engineering is a tool for moving genetic material, consisting mainly of DNA, while transgenics is a technique for constructing the gene to be inserted into the host. Tissue culture is initially used to develop the transgenic plant. Once the plant is produced, plant numbers can be increased through normal seed production. Transgenic techniques have been used on rice, cotton, and a variety of vegetable crops such as lettuce, cabbage, and tomato, as well as on tree and vines to develop cultivars resistant to insect and pathogen pests. Crop cultivars are now available that have transgenic components allowing them to tolerate herbicides to which they were previously susceptible and to produce proteins toxic to certain insects, or to be antagonistic to plant disease. While this technology holds much promise, there are many concerns regarding its use. Introduction of a gene from the bacterium Bacillus thuringiensis, BT, into a plant host, for instance, raises concerns about the chances of insect resistance to the BT endotoxin. Recently, a species of pigweed deemed a superweed is said to survive glyphosate applications in HT, herbicide-tolerant, soybean and corn, and is reducing yield tremendously. Some seed companies and experts suggest planting a refuge of susceptible cultivars in or around the field to reduce the potential for rapid development of resistance to transgenic cultivars. But the logistics for growers trying to carry out this recommendation can be cumbersome. Some biologists worry that widespread use of plants with altered genes could dilute the gene pool of wild species, threaten diversity, and upset the natural ecological balance of the ecosystem. While much remains to be learned, transgenic technology offers faster, more specific, and more varied options for creating new crop cultivars than ever before. Host plant resistance is just one of the many tools available for use in an integrated pest management program. In some situations, when heavy pest infestations occur, resistance breaks down, or control options are simply too expensive, the best option is to avoid the pest altogether through the use of alternate non-host plants. Non-host plants can be used in crop rotations to reduce pest numbers. In landscapes, non-host plants providing similar aesthetic qualities are frequently available. For example, cycads are plagued with cycad scale in Florida and are very difficult to control. An example of a non-host plant that looks similar is the chestnut diune. In conclusion, this video covered how resistance occurs in plants, types of breeding efforts, and genetic engineering, as well as using non-host plants as part of an IPM program.